this is the WeeLC match. So this is between Hornswoggle and El Torito.
Yeah.
And it took place at Extreme Rules 2014. Whenever I've seen it, I've been like, oh yeah, I remember that. It was a crap match, you know. And having watched it, no, I realise it is an absolute underrated classic by a group of people who you wouldn't have thought would have put on a match that was going to be anything like this good.
Yeah. Well, look, I think whenever you have three people in a commentary position that are tiny versions of the actual commentary position, WeeBL, Little Jerry King Lawler, or some bollocks, Micro Call.
that
ticks a lot of boxes.
It does. Yeah, I've said it before. They change their names because there is one thing about the commentators, and the commentators are not pro commentators, and they are legitimately bad. And the real commentary team make a lot of hay with that. They're really like, this is hilarious, they're the worst. But the commentary team, they do not even get their names right. So I think when they ask him what his name is, the first one, they say, what's your name? And he goes, Michael Cole. And they go, Micro Cole. Okay.
What's your name?
I'm Michael Cole.
Micro Cole.
Micro Cole.
And who are you?
There's Jerry the Mini King Lawler.
Right.
Who later in the match they refer to as Jerry the King Smaller. So he obviously forgot that entirely. And the other one is WeeBL. Again, Jay.
Jay does not sound like Wee.
It
not,
should
yeah,
be
no.
JWL.
Yes. Yeah. B Wee. That works. Yeah. JWL.
But they didn't even want him to be called that because later on they refer to him as JBLF. So the three
guys on one, you can't just change it halfway through.
But the three guys have obviously just gone into business in themselves. The first one says Michael Cole, totally wrong. The second one says Jerry the Little King Lawler.
Yes.
What are you doing? We had a writer work on this. It's like, oh no.
Tell everybody that just joined in that we have three very special announcers: Jerry Smaller, Michael Cole, and
JBLF.
JBLF.
What I love the most about this is it was a joke. It's a big joke. You get two guys, you call it WeeLC.
Yeah.
There's little ladders. There's all this, you know, little commentators and everything. But the two men involved, who are El Torito and Hornswoggle, they didn't want it to be a joke. And they won. So what they put on is a match that everyone was like, it's a throwaway, dumb bit of comedy. And the commentators keep that going through the commentary. So all they're doing is they are basically going, we know this is going to be an absolute shit fest, so we'll just amuse ourselves.
Yeah.
And they keep doing that even when the match
becomes
amazing. The crowd are chanting, this is awesome, at points. And I know that's an overused sort of chant. But for you to get a this is awesome in the middle of this match and not have the commentators react to it and go, this has blown away all expectations. But to still be there going, at one point they say something like, you know, unbelievably, this show is trending worldwide. You know, take it. It's done well.
Yeah.
So you have El Torito. That is the Spanish for the little bull. He was a wrestler called Mascarita Dorada, which is little golden mask in Spanish. He's 4'5" and he's what's referred to as a mini. So Mexico has a very, very much richer history of using people of diminutive stature as legitimate athletes. In the early years, they were also called micro luchador.
Oh, I like it.
Micro wrestlers. There were these small wrestlers. There was Gran Nicolai, a Pequeno Goliath, and my favorite one is Arturito, who was dressed as R2-D2 from Star Wars. Really popular.
How rigid was his kind of setup?
Like, I don't think it was. I think it was a costume. Yeah, that was done. I have not seen any of R2-E2's work. And R2-E2. I just love it. Again, it's that Mexican thing about copyright. Copyright is the start of a negotiation. We'll put him out there.
We'll stop doing it at some point. Once it's started losing money for us.
But look how absolutely delightful it is.
Yes, exactly.
In the early 1990s, CMLL, Mexico's oldest wrestling promotion, they actually created a division of mini estrellas. And that was really the first time it was anything but a sort of like novelty match in the middle of a card. It was created by a guy called Antonio Peña, who is very much the Vince McMahon of CMLL, passed away since. And he used this as well, where he sort of went, we could use this where they aren't just their own characters, but they could be miniature versions of our big stars. So it's like a sort of, I don't know,
like an action figure.
It's Funko Pops. Invents moving Funko Pops. In 1997, AAA, which was the other big federation in Mexico, they signed a working arrangement with the WWF. And the WWF specifically did that because they were interested in mini estrellas. They were sort of fascinating and sort of a novelty to some degree. And a lot of the big mini estrellas of the time, they came over to WWF. And some of them were given the Mexican gimmick of being miniature versions of the bigger stars.
Right.
So during that time in 1997, there was a mini golden Goldust and a mini Vader. There was a mini Mankind.
A mini Mankind and a mini Vader.
Yep. So they would have their matches. And it was almost like a sort of, they weren't going around with those wrestlers.
Yeah.
But it was almost like that thing of sort of going, here is a cartoon version of our terrifying main event.
Yeah.
El Torito, the little bull. He did actually appear in the 2014 Royal Rumble. He was a surprise entrant.
Right.
He eliminated Fandango and was eliminated.
Fandango's getting it.
He was eliminated in turn by Roman Reigns. Another reason to hate him.
Roman Reigns. Yeah. Good Lord.
And what you've got on the other side of this match is Hornswoggle.
Mm.
And Hornswoggle is more of a traditional diminutive
comedic
American performer. Yeah, he is very much a comedy character. Mm. He spent, before he came to WWE, 2 years in the independents. He was in NWA Wisconsin, where he billed himself as the world's sexiest midget short stack. And he signed with the WWE in 2006. He had a decade-long career, which is a really sort of impressive amount of time for someone who is never, ever going to be in the main event.
Yeah.
He came in first as Little Bastard.
Oh, that would have been a fun character. Yeah. Little Bastard.
He was Fit Finlay's leprechaun.
Little Bastard.
Later revealed to be Finlay's son.
That's right, yes.
And they renamed him Hornswoggle. In 2007, he won the Cruiserweight Championship from Jamie Noble at a time when they'd sort of lost interest in the Cruiserweight Championship. He was later revealed as being Vince McMahon's illegitimate son.
Mm.
Vince would go on to show some tough love by matching him up against the great Carly. And in 2010 was revealed as the anonymous Raw general manager a few times. But at this point in 2014, he turned heel and he'd aligned with Three-Man Band, who were a group of lower level performers who I think WWE had great hopes for. And then they pretty much just abandoned those hopes. Drew McIntyre, Jinder Mahal and Heath Slater. Those guys would go on in a couple of years to two of them be WWE champions. At this point, they are very much an afterthought.
Kind of thing, but it was my first standing ovation in Gorilla. And I remember it like it was yesterday. I didn't change out of my gear until the main event happened.
Wow.
I just wanted to sit. And like Torito was leaving the building. He goes, "You're not going to change?" I said, "No, man." He goes, "You okay?" I said, "I'm even better than you think."
Aww.
And it was just like,
but he was obviously at that point where I suppose you're beginning to think they're not really using me in the ring. They don't see me as I've done all of these things. Tick tock. And he never really asked, I don't think, to have anyone of the similar stature to come in. This match is pretty much the biggest match of diminutive stature performers that's happened in WWE for the last 20 years.
Mm.
And Hornswoggle took it very, very seriously. He said, "We got to WeeLC and we were told it needed to be gimmicky and haha, but we could do whatever."
Right.
And we did. Our goal that night was to play people away, and we surprised everyone. At one point, Drew McIntyre does a flip over the ropes to the outside and through a table for no reason. Everyone had the mindset of screw it, let's blow them away. And they really do. This match is short. I'm JBL, and that
is a joke.
That's the sum content of my of what I bring to this match. It's short, but it is absolutely, there is not a wasted second in it.
No.
And there are some absolutely brilliant bumps.
And the thing about El Torito is has got that proportional dwarfism where his legs and arms are in proportion, in ratio. So he can fucking move. Like
he is
nobody's
quick.
Business.
He has
it's like watching a child like do it. And it's like, fucking hell, where are the kids? Let that fuck out! Ah, he's on me!
He has got exactly the same body shape and proportion as my toddler. And she moves fast, but she doesn't move as confidently as Torito. Now, Torito, the other wonderful thing about him is, as a masked wrestler in Mexico, he's never been unmasked.
Mm.
His identity remains a closely guarded secret.
Well, until today, Mark. I'm only 5'8". I'm wearing lifts.
He is just, I mean, in this match, they also have a ring commentator.
Mm.
And in a weird way, the WWE, while they're sort of going, this is stupid, they've actually done it quite well in that everything is going, this is another world that you have entered.
Mm.
What you get with the ring announcer, he is absolutely, objectively, one of the worst people to do that job. He cannot get anything right. He has such a limited amount of things to do. He starts off by calling it the WLCC match, which is an extra C. And then he introduces Hornwoggle.
Hornwoggle, come on.
I know Hornswoggle's not like a big name that everyone's like, how could you get that wrong?
It's a bit basic.
Been told it beforehand. You know, he should get that right. El Torito comes out and he just, they bring him out between the capes of Los Matadors.
Mm.
And when he runs down, he jumps into the ring and everything. He just does this rope work where he's sort of bouncing, flipping over the ropes. And then he goes up the turnbuckle and everything.
Yeah.
And it's just
absolutely chilling.
If he was full size, you'd be like, oh, you're Spider-Man. That's definitely Spider-Man.
It's the sort of thing that he looks like he's sticking off everything.
Yeah, if he was 6 foot tall, he would be the biggest star in the entire industry, without a shadow of a doubt. The crowd are the best thing about this because the crowd are into it and the crowd don't treat it. They don't laugh at it and they aren't patronizing it. They're just going, these two guys are going out there and they are leaving nothing behind. Oh, it's so good. Torito is just incredible. He does a dive onto three-man band and it's just, I mean, it's impossible not to go, that is more impressive than seeing someone of full height do it.
Yeah.
You know, it's so much more complex to actually do.
He's the way that he leaps and jumps and stuff. He looks like he's not quite as bound to gravity as everyone else because he can throw himself further. He's quicker. He just seems more free than everyone else. He's not betrothed to the fucking gravity.
Before he was Mascarita Sagrada, he worked under the name Speedy Gonzalez. Mm. And there is something about that he is like the mouse Speedy Gonzalez. Yeah. Just absolute blurring around. What's really, I loved as well, is that Hornswoggle actually goes in and he does, if you like, the traditional American dwarf wrestling where he does a kick and he misses and he kicks himself in the forehead, which is something that a regular performer cannot do. When Hornswoggle's leg is straight out and he's bent down, he can kick his own forehead.
Yeah.
And there's little bits like that you go, he would have known this, but that is a move that's been happening in his particular branch of wrestling for a century.
Yeah.
And paying tribute, in a way, to all of that sort of stuff that goes ahead. Mm. So he cannot do what Torito does. So what he does is he does what Hornswoggle does. And there's a little bit, he grabs Torito's tail and Torito starts running and Hornswoggle cannot let go of the tail. Mm. He's sort of just like, you know, those bits you would have seen in America in the 30s and the 40s, you know, and it's like a celebration of a strand of wrestling that is not ever celebrated and is not taken seriously, largely because until we have the Mexicans coming along in the 90s, it has been pretty one note. I love the fact that in this match, which is the culmination of it on the biggest stage of them all, which is WWE, internationally seen, Hornswoggle is throwing those little bits in. I think that's a real sort of, it just makes me proud. He might just do it because someone said, you know, kick yourself in the head. Yeah, I just love it. The other thing to mention as well is how three-man band works so hard here. Mm. They are three performers. They know they're struggling. They're probably worried every time that there's a release of talent. And what they do in this match is they don't go in and go, this is beneath me. Mm. They go in and go, we're going to get this over as much as we can. And they take some insane bumps. Mm. Heath Slater gets a miniature chair shot in the nuts and then goes through a miniature table. There is one bit where the Matadors get Jinder Mahal up on their shoulders where they're on the ring apron, and Torito comes over a ladder with a crossbody onto Jinder Mahal and they go down through tables and ladders. And it is, when I was watching it the first time, I properly punched the air when it happened. Yes! That looked incredible. Just lovely touches. Hornswoggle brings out a tiny little ladder and the crowd obviously pop and he just shakes his head no, and he goes back under the ring and he brings out a slightly bigger small ladder. You know, lots of good sort of beautifully thought out little bits. You know, there's one great line as well done by the commentators where they talk about the WWE network, and at the time that was something you heard every 3 fucking seconds.
Yeah.
$9.99 WWE network. And one of the commentators says, how much is the WWE network? And the other one goes, well, we get it for half price, it's $4.48. And the full-size commentators, like jocks, are really good. Yeah, that's all right, that one. That's quite fun.
Yeah. There's
also a load of bit where they gripe about their own jobs through the prism of the other commentators. So the other commentators, they're sort of talking about it. And you see a Michael Cole just going, oh, this is like Raw. They're not calling the action. And it's, someone's been told off. It ends with Torito bouncing off the rope and giving a sitting senton to Hornswoggle, who goes through a mini table. Torito would later beat Hornswoggle again in the mask versus hair rematch that they had at WWE.
So he was next scene getting shaved, presumably.
He was, yeah. Again, you know, part of the, if you like, the history of wrestling, you know, you give the two guys the mask versus hair match. You know, it 100% is everything that good pro wrestling is.
Yeah.
It's fun without being, you know, silly. Two guys in it, it matters to them a lot. Mm. And you can see that it matters to them a lot. And they want to work hard to make this work. You can see that the people around the ring have so much respect for them that they are going to put their own bodies through tables in a non-comic way to get these guys over. Mm. And everyone working together, it's supposed to be athletic, it's supposed to be entertaining, it's supposed to be something you cannot see anywhere else outside of wrestling. And that match ticks every single one of those boxes.
The little fellow just wants to express himself. He wants the ability to talk.
Uh-huh. You want the ability to talk?
Uh-huh.
Well, uh-huh. Young man, you've had that all along.
Uh-huh.
Come here, young man.
There you go.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you.
Oh, you're welcome.
Thank you, Santa.
Oh,
I'm talking.
Oh,
thank you.
Holiday.
Twins. Tree. I'm talking.
Yes.
Menorah. And Dream. Dream, I'm talking.
It's a miracle.
I'm talking.
Stop.
Hot Rod, I'm talking.
Woo-hoo. When did the little guy learn how to talk? Amazing. It's a Christmas miracle.